Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Age of Atlantic Revolution, The Fall and Rise of a Connected World, by Patrick Griffin. Narrated by Steve Menasche. Prologue. So it all began with some rope. In July 1776, just days after the Declaration of Independence had been adopted, a group of New Yorkers assembled on the Commons to celebrate the break from Britain before marching down to the Bowling Green at the southern tip of Manhattan. Here, a statue to King George III on horseback, replete with classical garb, had been erected only 6 years before. Made of lead, the statue was gilded and rested on a marble pedestal, all of which stood 15 feet high. The General Assembly had commissioned the statue in 1766 because of the innumerable and singular benefits the king had rendered the colony, particularly delivering it lately from the utmost confusion and distress, but repeal of the Stamp Act. No less a personage than John Adams had admired the statue when he had visited the city earlier. Now the New Yorkers meant to pull it down. How things had changed in only a few years. When citizens and soldiers of the Continental Army threw ropes around their sovereign and pulled, they decried, "The folly and pretended goodness of the real George have made upon their minds, which have effectually poisoned and destroyed their souls." With the ropes, as one newspaper in Maryland declared, the knot is cut. The symbolic act of regicide did not end there. The men and women lopped off the head of the statue in a move reminiscent of the execution of Charles I a century earlier and placed it on a pike. One loyalist was able to get his hands on the desecrated and now uncrowned head of the statue, buried it for safekeeping, and then dug it up to send to Britain to a former Lord Lieutenant of Ireland named George Townsend, all to demonstrate the intentions of some of the colonists. The savior of the head had ample reason to worry. The despoilers sent the rest of the statue to Connecticut to be melted down into bullets. In all, 42,088 were made from the metal. The numbers 42 and 88 represented totemic symbols for British nationhood, tied as they were to key events that took place in 1642 and 1688, during which the English decided to topple other kings. These bullets would be used in the fight for liberty that ensued. The New Yorkers hoped the emanations from the leaden George would make deep impressions on the British. Indeed, they would. The toppling of this statue in particular has mythically come to be associated with the loosening of bonds, an untethering from an old order. It would come to be seen as the first scene of the first act of revolution by those living at the time, and for us today. What those with the rope could not quite have articulated were transformations on an epic scale beyond their ability to comprehend fully. Beneath the invocation of ideas, seismic changes were remaking the Atlantic world. As much as by new concepts of the person, of governance, and of the economy, the period was defined by broad systemic shifts to which all people had to adapt. The process that was reshaping a system that touched four continents, North and South America, Europe and Africa, and that reverberated farther still, was both troubling and exhilarating, even if it was not quite understood. States would be challenged to keep up with it. Their officials usually tried to do so by reforming the structures or practices in place, and people, like the New Yorkers, responded in kind. Trite as it sounds, The world was changing profoundly long before the New Yorkers used ropes to announce they would not be tied down. What had been the assumed ways of doing things were now in danger of becoming obsolete. Conventional ideas and ways of organizing politics, the economy, and society could not keep pace with the changing system. Political arrangements tying empires together were ill-equipped to address new concerns. What bound the whole together had become a question, and to some people at least, older ways of appreciating power could not do justice to the challenge of the new. Old symbols no longer fit. The experiences of those on the very edges of that system proved a harbinger of what was to come and what would define the period as an age. How the New Yorkers responded also served as an example, writ small, of the stresses and tensions nearly all societies were to deal with. Concerns that would ensure new statues would arise after old ones fell. From Paris to Port-au-Prince, and from Boston to Buenos Aires, and all the interconnected points in between. Introduction. What these New Yorkers also could not have fathomed is how the tugging of a rope would inaugurate what the Irish radical Dennis Driscoll would call the Age of Revolution. He was hardly alone in making such a bold pronouncement. The much more conservative John Adams intoned in 1815 that ours is the age of revolution and constitutions, yoking the breakdown of authority and its rebuilding in one phrase. In 1762, Jean-Jacques Rousseau had prophesied un siècle de révolution, as had Voltaire in 1772. In his first inaugural address in 1801, Thomas Jefferson referred to the period as an age of revolution and reformation. A generation later, after events in Latin America, Lyman Beecher preached that the period ushered in an age of revolution and war. Almost canonically, the avatar of the promise of the period, Thomas Paine, enthused, it is an age of revolutions in which everything must be looked for. The age of revolution transformed all. After the New Yorkers tore down the statue, the spirit of liberty, almost like a current of electricity, would course across America. It would then travel to France, throughout the continent, and the Caribbean, back to the British Isles, and eventually finding its way to Latin America and Africa. The ensuing conflagration destroyed empires, and saw a new understanding of the sovereign power of the state arise from these ashes. It unleashed, it spread, it purified. It would, with time, outlaw slavery, remake reigning ideas of political economy, refashion the status of women, and shake the political landscape. Throughout the Atlantic world from the 1760s through the 1820s, nothing and nobody would be untouched. This earlier age made the modern world. As monuments throughout Brazil, Spanish America, all of Europe, Britain and Ireland, North America, the Caribbean, and West Africa attest, the Atlantic was turned upside down in the late 18th and early 19th century. What would have been unimaginable in 1750, say the idea that popular sovereignty would be the bedrock of government, proved the rule rather than the exception by 1830. There is another side. The age begot violence and war. It rode on waves of fear and disorder. It unleashed, it spread, it corrupted. Power was reorganized, as was society, but the tumultuous transition from an old order to a new one did not make for a world of unfettered possibilities. The age ushered in a new era of global empires that would reshape, perhaps decimate, the lives of indigenous peoples across the globe. The age resulted in the reinvigoration of slavery in places, the use of reason to justify the rule of the few over the many, modern and pernicious conceptions of race and subordination, the empowering of states that could overwhelm the individual, the triumph of unregulated free trade that saw whole portions of the earth marginalized to enrich others. The list could go on. It was one of history's hinges, a moment upon which everything turned, often for the worse. The age, as Paine's bête noire, Edmund Burke, came to fear, would fetter many more than it would free. It was, as Charles Dickens said, the best of times and the worst of times. For this reason, and because of the ways this earlier period in the Atlantic marks our world to this day, shelves groan with penetrating interpretations of the age. What sets this book apart? Well, let's return to Paine and Burke for a moment. For a start, consider the bonds between them. They first became personally acquainted over, of all things, a bridge-building scheme Paine was planning. In 1788, Paine wrote Burke a letter as we begin the world without knowing it will be long or short. He knew the length of the span he hoped to construct. The quiet field of science has more amusement to my mind than politics, and I had rather erect the largest ark in the world than be the greatest emperor in it, he told Burke. Burke hosted the great American Paine at his home for some time, and they came to know each other reasonably well. What each saw in the other were the possibilities of connections. Burke understood that Paine was tied to a cadre of first-rate thinkers in both the old world and the new. Few were better networked with the great and the good in the British Isles than Burke. More significantly, of course, the one responded to the other throughout this tumultuous period. Paine, after all, wrote Rights of Man to refute Burke. In fact, Paine opens his preface to the English edition of Rights of Man with these words. From the part Mr. Burke took in the American Revolution, it was natural that I should consider him a friend to mankind. Their acquaintance, as he observed, commenced on that ground. As early as 1777, Burke had characterized the celebrated author of Common Sense as a catalyst that prepared the minds of the people for independence. How that sense of camaraderie changed. By 1790, Burke came to believe Paine was preparing the world for something quite different from liberation. When Paine decided to take aim at the British establishment, Burke wrote, I am happy to find that practical Paineism has not extended itself that way, and that the iron bridge, which I was guilty of introducing, has not yet been like the bridge over Milton's chaos, and high road for all the devils of anarchy to pass. Such growing animosity between the Titans obscures a deeper link. Both participated in networks that spanned the ocean and bound continents together. Both writers saw themselves as part of a broader world of reference points that incorporated places as dispersed as Cartagena and Berlin. All these places, as well as their histories, have been imaginatively amalgamated into a connected whole. And both, Burke and Paine, relied on a common inheritance to try to make sense of what was happening to their world. A span of iron may not have tied them together, but so much more did. This book focuses on such connections. The circulation of people, things, and ideas bound the disparate parts of the Atlantic together, a development that deepened once crisis began. Notions of entanglement and connection, what the French call histoire croisée or histoire connectée, are much esteemed by historians today, perhaps too much so. But no other terms capture more fully what made the 18th century so enthralling and so vexing. The book argues that the changes that transformed the world and made ours were bound up in the many ways men and women tried to make sense of an intensely networked system changing before their eyes. The knotty challenges of the period also tested the abilities of states to manage the Atlantic. The crises that brought on revolution emerged from attempts to disentangle the world. Only when states came into being that could do so would revolution end. Only a new kind of state could rebind what had been unwound. In the process, people transformed themselves. The period illustrated the creative ability of men and women to adapt to wrenching changes and to reshape the societies in which they lived. Even if they remade the Atlantic in unintended or even unfathomable ways, they always did so in light of the many connections tying their world together. From conventional perspectives, the study of the Age of Revolution presents awkward challenges, most especially because the chronologies of the dynamics in so many different places so far from one another do not line up. After all, revolution began in North America in the 1770s and started in Latin America more than a generation later. Moreover, can we characterize what happened far from the Atlantic coast as part of a broader pattern? But if we think of revolution along less conventional and more enmeshed lines, a new chronological and geographic roadmap of the period comes into focus. The American Revolution did not come to a fitting and simple conclusion in 1787. The French Revolution did not simply begin in 1789. Unrest in Spanish and Portuguese holdings before independence movements also had revolutionary implications. What took place in African societies, in places like Prussia, and in Native American communities far from the ocean bore the stamp of the age. When we think of connection, the terms center and periphery can often have less purchase. In fact, a place like Haiti stands at the very heart of the period and its fundamental features because of how it was tied to the broader Atlantic. What happened in one place, then, informed what would occur elsewhere. Pulling the thread in one seemingly isolated corner of a network could have dramatic implications for people and places an ocean away. What follows here is not a conventional history, or a study for that matter. It is, for lack of a better word, a synopsis. I mean this term in the way a scholar of the New Testament would use it. The book does not offer a blow-by-blow account of what happened. What single volume could? It proposes instead a brief look at the whole to outline the stories of the constituent parts. Synopsis implies viewing the whole and the parts that animate it simultaneously. As such, the book moves between broad, systemic changes in many places and the ways men and women in their locales tried to make sense of them, assign meaning to them, and act upon them. Such a synoptic understanding, not so ironically, reached its high point during the age itself, when a German theologian named J.J. Griesbach repurposed an age-old way of viewing three or four Gospels side by side to see how they were connected and what such intermingling meant for the larger story the Gospels propounded. This book does much the same by offering meditations on the beginning, middle, and end of the revolutionary process as it played out across the broad Atlantic in 100 years from 1750 to 1850. It does so by relying on all of the wonderful work done on Atlantic history over the past generation and the many studies of its constituent parts on this critical period. To synopsize means looking at representative cases and relating them to one another and a larger narrative. It invites comparison. In fact, it demands comparison. The Atlantic can only be appreciated in specific contexts. Nevertheless, the specific only makes sense in light of the Atlantic. Comparing particulars helps us appreciate the big picture and its various aspects in more compelling ways. For the beginning, we survey the whole, charting how global patterns of change transformed the Atlantic during the 18th century, necessitating imperial reform. The book then centers on the first society to experience revolutionary tumult, British North America. The American case illustrates how an age of empire became an era of revolution because of a crisis of connection. We then travel to the next places to experience the shocks of the period. Prominent among them, France, Saint-Domingue, and Ireland, to appreciate the central features of revolution during the age. Hope, fear, and aggression. Many of the specifics and the stories surveyed here are well known. The book tries to characterize them anew through the prism of the broader picture presented. We wrap up with a study of endings by charting dynamics in the last region to be pulled into the crucible, Latin America, and one place that seemed by the end of the proverbial day to have held at bay the whipsawing effects of the age, Britain. We do so to understand how men and women in these and other places tried to bring the process of revolution to a close. The final chapter takes us once again through the whole Atlantic, but one now transformed by examining nation-building and memorialization, the final steps in binding the whole and its constituent parts together after the unraveling of the old order. Throughout these studies, other places, often left out of conventional treatments, are folded into this story of the Atlantic Age. In other words, the book weaves the chronological with the geographic and the thematic, just as the local is interlaced with the broader and the comparative with the sequential. The sum total is an understanding of how the Atlantic-wide process unfolded through time. No aspect of the process was hermetically sealed. Revolutionary origins for British North America informed events elsewhere. What happened in Latin America reverberated in the United States, challenging the revolutionary settlement there. Events in the Caribbean shook Brazil, West Africa, and the British Isles, and connections between France and the rest of the world shaped beginnings and endings throughout the Atlantic. The book examines this complex interweaving throughout, just as we would study, say, the Synoptic Gospels. The whole only makes sense when we pull together what are usually seen as discrete dynamics with those occurring far away and when we see how they relate to one another. Once we see things in this way, the age can have apparent and unappreciated beginnings and a number of possible endings. It began when the idea of turning out an old order transfixed people, such as when the New Yorkers grabbed their ropes and beheaded the statue of their king. It also had its start well before people on the ground could even comprehend seismic changes challenging the accepted arrangements of how society was to be structured. A revolutionary era began, therefore, as event and as process, in ways that people could articulate with ideas and in ways they could not. It may have ended that way as well. Similarly, sometimes men and women were conscious of connections, at other times not. Ultimately, men and women tried to give meaning to that which lay just over the horizon of comprehension. As they did so, people throughout the Atlantic debated how to impose the power of the state onto a dynamically changing system. Revolution represented the intense competition to accomplish this feat, and people throughout the Atlantic, whether they liked it or not, were caught up in the process and struggle of articulating the fit between sovereignty and system, as the world seemed to reel around them. Along the way, this book parses the phrase Age of Revolution, First, what is an age? It is, of course, a construct, and men and women in the late 18th and early 19th century came to believe they were living during an exhilarating and terrifying, but ultimately epical moment. They came to such a conclusion by seeing things in places far removed as intrinsically connected. Add to this that the very idea also could have almost talismanic appeal. Such sensibilities captured imaginations at different junctures for different places. When, where, and why matter? Second, the book wonders whether to consider this age a moment of revolution or of revolutions. Think of the difference. The former conjures up a single movement, the second, a series of perhaps connected eventualities. The plural implies national or regional disruptions that could appear distinctive. The singular brings to mind the sum total of all these experiences. Perhaps we should ask how the universal and the particular related. Finally, the book tangles with the question of what a revolution is. Here we get to especially vexing terrain. According to a writer who tried his hand at defining the term many years ago, revolution is one of the looser words. Indeed, the word connotes, of course, some sense of progress and a program for change, the idea that it can be a force unto itself. However, revolution also suggests a process with a beginning, a middle, and an end, when one society after another was remade and through which sovereignty was recrafted. Could revolution be both at once? The book applies these simple questions to the whole Atlantic. It covers this complicated terrain by taking us through the entangled and connected origins, central features, and conclusions of this stupendous upheaval. It discusses how people struggled through violence, liberation, and war, and in the process came to imagine themselves and the state in new ways. From this imaginative process, all hinging on finding a form of sovereignty that could manage the imperatives of the international system and of the moment, men and women from North and South America, Africa and Europe, singly and together, would remake the world. Chapter 1. A Tangled World. The Atlantic in the 18th Century. Some of the greatest writers in the 18th century focused their finest work on an age-old paradox that defined the Atlantic on the eve of revolution. The Londoner Daniel Defoe and the Dubliner Jonathan Swift published Robinson Crusoe and Gulliver's Travels in 1719 and 1726, respectively. They would become the two most widely read stories of the 18th century, translated into many European languages. They both suggest the lure of adventure. In Robinson Crusoe, the headstrong young man heads to sea only to be shipwrecked. The ocean captured him and his imagination in the most literal way. "I would be satisfied with nothing but going to sea," Crusoe declares, even to the point of ignoring the will, nay, the commands of my father. Conventional bonds would not hold him. He dreams of escape. He then finds himself in a state of nature and has to reconstruct society from the ground up. Swift's Lemur Gulliver starts as a mature man, eager to explore, and as a student of medicine and science, to see what makes the world tick. Gulliver claims an insatiable desire of seeing foreign countries. To do so, he knows he has to head to sea, so he teaches himself navigation and other parts of mathematics useful to those who intend to travel. The darker aspects of venturing are evident in both accounts as well. At one point, Gulliver is tied down, forced to do the work of a mean and little people. Even as he is ordered by his new tiny masters to overawe their foes and do what he cannot in conscience do, bring a free and brave people into slavery. I found, he recounts, my arms and legs were strongly fastened on each side of the ground. The little men, petty in stature and in demeanor, then put him to use through coercion, offering sustenance as they do so. Shipwrecked after he himself has been held captive, Crusoe makes his way to Brazil and subsequently agrees to venture to Africa to find men and women to enslave. He then most famously enslaves Friday when he tries to build his world. If we want to understand the paradoxical nature of the Atlantic world in the 18th century, we should consider an even more representative writer. One who has traveled and experienced the world that Defoe and Swift only described in prose. He did so bound like Gulliver and Friday. Here's how his tale begins. Olaudah Equiano was born in modern-day Nigeria in what was known as Igboland. In 1756, just as all European powers were engaged in a new conflict, he was kidnapped along with his sister and then sold to other Africans engaged in slaving. He was one of more than 53,000 Africans captured for the Atlantic slave market in that year. In the years that followed, the annual numbers would continue to grow. Equiano recounted how he was sold from master to master and eventually was moved near the coast, where he first encountered Europeans. Here he saw his new world. The first object which saluted my eyes when I arrived on the coast, he wrote, was the sea and slave ship, which was then riding at anchor and waiting for its cargo. In a slaving factory, a site where European avarice met African indigenous practices, he was uprooted from all he knew dear. He was placed on a ship set to sail to the New World. Now he endured the trauma of the Middle Passage, sail in the New World, and cruelties at the hands of a number of masters in the Caribbean and in Virginia. Every bit as much as Swift and Defoe, Equiano wrote a gripping adventure story that suggests how the Atlantic captured imaginations. He composed, if you will, an 18th-century odyssey that, like the tales of Gulliver and Crusoe, centered on the ocean. Though he was enslaved, shipboard life defined his world. He toiled for a while on the plantation, and eventually was sold to a master who traded with French, British, and Dutch merchants in numerous ports. Over the course of his time as an enslaved person, he traveled to Cadiz, Oporto, Nice and Belle Isle, Falmouth and London, New York, Savannah, Port-au-Prince, Havana, Kingston, and Cartagena. In other words, as his memoir attests, he crisscrossed the Atlantic throughout his life, making his way to all the chief ports of the imperial powers of the day. Along the way, he witnessed shocking cruelties, as, for instance, when he saw an African tortured in Montserrat. With time, Equiano would find his way to England, where he purchased his own freedom. He wrote of how he was baptized in London, embraced the vital piety coursing throughout the Atlantic at the time, and then joined a society dedicated to ending the slave trade. Eventually, he would become an important symbol for abolitionists. Like Defoe and Swift, he would write to try to understand the essential characteristics of his time and place and to make his way in society. Equiano's story revealed the barbarity of the institution of slavery and its central significance to the 18th century. This, of course, we know. What it also underscores is how the institution of slavery drove the creation of an Atlantic system that so beguiled Swift, Defoe, and Equiano himself. The movement that was part of Equiano's life was shared by hundreds of thousands of others, free and unfree. The ships he worked on, along with thousands of others, brought the goods that drew the old world closer to the new. What had been places divided by an ocean were now imaginatively bound together as one. This rebinding of old and new, too, underscored the appeal of writing about travel. Most critically, these worlds were tied together through the work and suffering of so many others like Equiano. "Surely this traffic cannot be good," he reckoned, "which spreads like a pestilence and taints what it touches, which violates that first natural right of mankind, equality and independence, and gives one man a dominion over his fellows which God could never intend." From London to Paris, the liberating notions he gave voice to arose along with the trade that was the period's most manifest debasement. The Atlantic-wide crisis that would define a generation and be termed an age began with the experiences and assumptions of people such as Equiano, Swift, and Defoe, and the terrors and hopes about which they wrote. Through the work of the enslaved and the ships that brought them to the New World, networks emerged that turned the Atlantic from a geographic space into a system, one that entranced writers and readers. This transformation would have dramatic effects for how people understood themselves and the world around them. The process laid out new possibilities for many, just as it structured new limits for so many more. It suggested freedom and exploitation. Most critically, the manner in which the Atlantic was integrated challenged older ways of conceiving of space, time, and change itself. This is indeed what Swift, Equiano, and Defoe were up to. The Atlantic became a place of intertwining allegiances, exploitation, and opportunity. Its entanglements led to adventure. They also occasioned war, amplified the power of the state, and led to all sorts of new competition between world powers. Transformations also presaged the advent of new ways of conceiving of trade, mobility, and labor. The changes were global in scope. Lines of commerce and authority bound the whole world together by tying together subsystems of exchange, in the same way Gulliver was tethered to the beach. Yet changes played most poignantly in the Atlantic. Here, networks grew more dense and tangled. Here, thousands sailed, some free, many more unfree. Here, goods and ships created channels of communication, and new media emerged to animate the new system. Here, people like Defoe would question the very basis of culture and society. The Atlantic became the focus of seismic changes because here states competed with one another and tried to assert themselves through war-making. Eventually, the vast transformations associated with consolidation of the system would create tensions that would lead to an Atlantic-wide crisis. Revolution would begin because of that crisis. This was the world Equiano, Swift, and Defoe created in life and on paper, and the one all people of the period had to navigate. That the Atlantic captured the imagination of all people living along its coastlines was not new. From the moment Europeans began imagining the Americas less as a new world, and more as an extension of the old to be exploited and competed over, the ocean became less of a mysterious barrier and more of a saltwater road. settlers from European regions, influenced by the Columbian Exchange and the emerging imperial economies, peopled new and far-off lands. While Native Americans struggled with disease in their own new world, Africans were drawn into the maelstrom of encounters in the most pernicious way. Demonized by Europeans as inferior, some were captured by traders and pirates to be sold into chattel slavery in the Americas. States vied with one another for the spoils of the Americas, and some regions, such as the Caribbean, became competitive crucibles of conflict. All the while, the goods from the Americas transformed European patterns of consumption, and soon whole societies were addicted to tobacco and sugar. Although it is anachronistic to use the term, we call the economic arrangements that bound center to colony mercantilist. Though the term mercantilism was in fact coined in the 19th century, the idea has some utility. The premise was simple. Colonies would provide raw materials that would be shipped to the center. Those at the center, given the predominant ways of conceiving of trade, wanted to bring in more specie than would leave. Colonies, many created by companies and some planned by the state, existed to benefit the mother country economically. English colonies were yoked like spokes on a wheel to London, French settlements to Paris, and others in similar fashion. There were any number of Atlantic worlds, however tenuously each was held together. System is really too strong a word. What they shared in common, albeit along parallel lines, was the exploitation of land and the victimization of indigenous peoples to gain access to that land. If colonizers had the wherewithal to ignore Native Americans, which defined the experience of the Spanish and the English, they did. If they did not have the numbers, such as was the case with the French, they cooperated, but with an eye to eventual dominance. All sorts of political arrangements bound these Atlantic empires together. We use the word empire to describe how the space was managed. However, the term is a bit of a misnomer. In fact, these composite states may have been held together by vaunting ideologies, but little else. Some were ruled as if they were centralized. The French Empire, that reached to the interior of North America, offers an ideal type of this sort. Yet, even if the crown claimed to rule this empire, on the ground, it was a ramshackle affair, managed by relationships forged between traders, natives, and priests. If fish, furs, and faith created this empire, precious little else sustained it. Other empires, like the English, had little rhyme or reason. England ruled dependencies in any number of ways. Through company charters, by way of powerful proprietary clients, with direct royal government, as kingdoms, as factories, or through archaic medieval contrivances. A great deal of governance was bound into patronage networks. The Spanish fell somewhere between the two. They claimed to have a bureaucracy created for their ultramarine holdings, but powerful local Creoles, that is, people born and raised in the colonies, saw to their own affairs. The empire was divided into rational administrative units, viceroyalties and provinces, and audiencias, but it really functioned as a mosaic. Sovereignty in the period was of a porous quality. Metropolitan officials were generally happy to have Creoles rule their worlds as they saw fit, so long as they could sustain a limited set of political and economic goals while maintaining some semblance of order and not complicating imperial rivalries. The state existed with a limited sense of what it was and what it could accomplish. The myths of sovereign rule had a powerful appeal and often were rooted in medieval institutions, such as the crown, or in Britain's case, the crown inn, another medieval institution, parliament. The state maintained the orderliness of society, and this arrangement had more or less held together since the time of the Reformation. Yet for all the official bluster about sovereignty, the state did not have the capacity to make good on its claims of control. In fact, even regions close to the center enjoyed autonomy. Those living on imperial margins paid deference to the rhetoric of control or imperial grandeur, but in fact, the state could not exercise authority, except close to home and not in a sustained manner. This happened for different reasons. The French, for instance, had created a bureau of colonies to manage empire in a centralized fashion. But the navy did not have the ability to make good on articulated aims. Everyone tended to wink and nod and get on with their lives. Only episodically did state power impinge. The Atlantic represented only one part of a broader global dynamic. Nonetheless, the Atlantic became the chief site of ambition of European hopes and dreams, however modest they were at this time. By the end of the 17th century, it had become a space defined by metropolitan pretensions of control, the development of Creole cultures far away from the center with a great deal of autonomy, and whole groups exploited for land and for labor. The Spanish offer perhaps the most idealized type of the Atlantic kaleidoscope. They controlled the wealth-producing regions of Peru and Mexico. They had holdings from the Caribbean to Cape Horn and north of the Rio Grande. Officials believed they had created a highly bureaucratized colonial structure, centralized in design, and they worked to create a closed network. With mining as the central feature of the imperial economy, and with locals able to control indigenous peoples in their midst, officials could keep an eye on rivals. The conceit of control was based on a world in which competition could be managed. The ties that bound the centers to the peripheries proved tenuous at best. The comings and goings of ships were not regularized. The governments of London, Paris, Madrid, and Lisbon only intervened in colonial affairs intermittently, usually during times of crisis. Questions still abounded of how peripheries would be governed, regardless of metropolitan pretensions of sovereign status, but few saw the need to address such questions. In this era of arrangements, if we could call it that, such ways of doing things functioned as well as could be expected, and usually no one asked for much more. As William Butler Yeats would say, all was about to change utterly and quickly. We tend to think of our age as the first era of globalization. Nothing could be further from the truth. The 18th century witnessed dramatic change, challenging older ways and precedents. But in this earlier period of global transformation, ambitions centered on one part of the world, the place that was most intensely networked, the Atlantic. Between 1713 and the mid-1740s, the Atlantic, the Americas, and Europe in general experienced what could be called a long peace. The term does not refer only to North America, when the Iroquois and Algonquin-speaking peoples in the Great Lakes region ended endemic warfare and hammered out an accommodation. It refers to the period when hostilities over global domination between European powers ceased, for the time being at least. In this moment, what could be called the Pax Atlantica, the Atlantic was transformed as networking intensified. With peace, the lives of all in this period began to revolve around global patterns of movement, centered on the Atlantic, involving people, goods, and ideas. The 18th century differed profoundly from the period preceding it. The scope and scale of movement and trade grew immensely in the 18th century. The Spanish, in fact, would be the first to see the contours of this new world. Its truck and feeder lines became much more complex as peripheral societies developed and diversified. This story of change and adaptation, though, is anything but straightforward. It is complex and variegated. Atlantic transformation depended on migration and commerce. It also rested on coercion. To understand it fully, we should start with this dynamic. As settlers in the New World began to gain a greater hold of interior regions wrested from indigenous peoples, they looked to the Old World for the labor necessary to make land more productive. A greater reliance on the enslaved from Africa became the answer. In the process, the Atlantic was remade. All told, 11 million men and women from Africa were sent to the New World before the complete abolition of the slave trade, both licit and illicit, in the 1870s. The vast majority were enslaved in the 18th century. Societies with slaves soon became slave societies, that is, places dominated by the institution of slavery. Slavery proved the catalyst to the transformation of the Atlantic. With the direct exportation of men and women from Africa, ship crossings became more predictable. Networks became denser. The products that the enslaved provided with their labor, such as tobacco, sugar, rice, and coffee, were sent to Europe. Think of Glasgow and its ties to the tobacco trade in the British American colonies. Slave labor transformed the city. Through the trade, the tobacco lords refashioned the cultural and economic life of a city that became an important hub for the import and export of the leaf. Meanwhile, trade within and among colonies grew apace. With slave labor, the 18th century became the Atlantic century, and there could be no denying its exploitative nature. To cite just one example, French cities were to rise or fall with the ups and downs of the slave market and slave economy. Bordeaux, Nantes, Marseille, and Le Havre competed with one another for the spoils of the slave-based plantation economy in the Caribbean. A large proportion of the shipping of each place went to Saint-Domingue in the 18th century, by and large because nearly half of the world's sugar was processed there, as well as most of its coffee, and merchants from these cities in France came to own plantations in the slave colony. Sugar played an outsized role in the Atlantic and in Saint-Domingue, the place most closely associated with it. It lagged behind only Brazil in the number of the enslaved it consumed. In fact, with the sale and oppression of Africans in Saint-Domingue, these French cities entered a golden age. It is difficult to underestimate the significance of Saint-Domingue to the changing Atlantic economy in and cultural contours of the 18th century. Saint-Domingue emerged as the richest capital-producing site in the Americas. Coercion could keep production going. Not only did the colony bind the French Old World to the New, it also served as the center of the greater French Caribbean. French New Orleans, for instance, depended on Saint-Domingue, both as a site of connection and as a model. The port city, which tied the Mississippi to farms in the Illinois country, and this region to the Great Lakes and the center of New France in Quebec, was first and foremost a Caribbean society. It was to be another Saint-Domingue, both commercially and in terms of how planters would treat the enslaved. It, too, quickly adopted the Code Noir, and its linkages to the more important slave society in the French Caribbean mimicked and paralleled the British relationship between coastal South Carolina and Barbados. Saint-Domingue, then, stood as one of the age's great Caribbean nexuses, and for the French, the preeminent. The Atlantic served as a midwife to a global shift of integrated markets that we associate with capitalism. Again, slavery explains a great deal of how this happened. Take the case of Brazil. Brazil had been a slave society from its origins as a Portuguese colony. In the 17th century, sugar began to dominate some regions, and Portuguese mariners, who had been selling men and women from Africa to all comers, focused their efforts on Brazil. Astutely, sugar was called the engenho of society. Soon, Brazil would have other drivers. With the opening of gold mines, slave importation reached new heights. Bahia took in 5,000 to 8,000 of the enslaved a year, and it is estimated that 40% of all those imported from Africa arrived in Brazil to feed its insatiable demand of labor. The gold mining industry secured the link between Africa and Brazil, turning the ocean in between into a coherently organized economic space. The upshot for the Portuguese Atlantic was that parts of Africa and Brazil became as one. Slavery connected them. The story of Olauda Equiano demonstrates the ways that Atlantic ties now bound people and connected far-flung regions. The sort of factories where he was bought and sold had become the chief nodes of Atlantic consolidation, and they served as entrepôts reaching deep into the African interior and thence to ports in the New World. His story was not unique. The integration of whole regions in Africa into an exploitative Atlantic transformed them in fundamental ways. Whether the people were considered Igbo or were Catholics from the Kingdom of the Congo, and whether the slave traders sailed under British, Spanish, or Portuguese flags, European demand for New World labor encouraged the capture and sale of men and women to fuel further development of the Atlantic economy, yoking together places like Guyana and Liverpool in the bargain. Of course, the immense growth of the slave trade from 1680 to the end of the 18th century had dramatic implications for culture and society in West Africa. The leap in demand changed the tenor of African slavery and of slave raiding. Warfare also grew in intensity in some regions as the price of persons increased. The growth of the trade in humans encouraged other forms of trade as well. Africans wanted more European goods. People in Senegal, for instance, hoped to procure everything from basins to iron bars. Rulers were able to collect customs duties on the enslaved. They also needed more weapons and European goods as the slave trade fomented regional conflict, all of which encouraged further slave raiding. Others were overwhelmed by the new demands on the state, and in some places, disorder was becoming the order of the day. This, in turn, created yet more uncertainty and a further weakening of states, which contributed to more raiding and fighting, and so it went. The Igbo or Igbo country, where Equiano was captured, is a perfect example. It became one of the largest suppliers of men and women for the Atlantic market because of its fragmented sovereignty and the concomitant failure of order. This is how West Africa was connected to the whole. The end result? The state could not handle the new demands of the Atlantic, and war was becoming endemic. As more lands were opened up to productive use, free migration also increased. Men and women from the very margins of Europe now sought their destinies in a land-rich and labor-starved new world. Countrysides were commodified in much the same way labor was, as all were drawn into the Atlantic maw. Irish and German men and women headed to North America, creating tensions with the descendants of English men and women already there, while settlers from Cantabria and Spain left for New Spain, Mexico. New migrants also came from the Canary Islands, Galicia, Asturias, and the Basque Country. These mobile men and women opened up new areas to settlement and to productive use, increasing the size of hinterlands tied to provincial trading centers. Basques soon enmeshed themselves in the Creole elite of Santiago de Chile. Philadelphia grew into the predominant city in British North America as migrants came in and claimed new land for mixed farming, then sent their crop surpluses to the city and out into the Atlantic, enriching merchants, both those trading in people and those trading in goods as they did so. The same went for the humble and ambitious men and women who headed to places like Mexico City. They came, as one put it, to make America. In a remarkably short period of time, links tied English, French, Spanish, and Portuguese societies in the Americas to their respective metropoles more tightly than before. These links occurred in parallel fashion. Silk woven in Spitalfields in London embellished bodies in Philadelphia. Sugar grown in the French Caribbean sweetened the chocolate of consumers in Paris. Silver mined in New Spain adorned jewelry in Cadiz. Throughout discrete Atlantics, a consumer revolution gripped the imagination of everyone tied to the Atlantic. The ocean exploded in goods, and the supply affected the demands of courtiers and journeymen in places as varied as Paris, London, Philadelphia, and Buenos Aires. With increased flows, the reach of the Atlantic grew. The catchment area for Philadelphia stretched into the backcountry of the Carolinas. Scope and scale increased dramatically with integration, pulling more people into the webs of an increasingly networked world as they did so. The Atlantic depended upon such symbiotic relationships, now essentially made possible by the growing wealth of a merchant elite. The changes depended on goods, a rising middle class, the growth of the commercial power of a number of trading nations, and unprecedented demographic shifts. All imperial centers and their provinces an ocean away experienced as much. The saltwater space became a set of imperial systems running in parallel with one another. More critical for the story of the Revolutionary Age than the parallel development of the Atlantic was the interconnected nature of imperial/colonial systems. Interconnection occurred in licit and illicit ways. Here is just one small but telling example. Images of the Prussian monarch appeared on enameled snuff boxes filled with tobacco from America traded by other nations. Think of the sorts of complex connections this one object reveals. Or take a more conventional story. We now know that French trade with the rest of the world increased by more than 4 times and tenfold with its colonial holdings over the course of the century, mostly underwritten by the trade to and from the Sugar Islands. In the French case, smuggling accounted for a great share of that flow, which was outstripping political controls put in place in the previous century to ensure colonies served metropoles. Nantes and Bordeaux grew through such tangled trade. Soon, networks became denser, and France passed more trade through Spanish Cadiz than any other power. Meanwhile, as the demand for the enslaved became voracious in the French Caribbean, Dutch traders filled in when French shipping could not supply requisite numbers. So normal was smuggling in some French port towns, such as New Orleans, that officials did not bother to comment on trade with Spain. Doing so did not even entail a wink or a nod. In fact, officials condoned it. Meanwhile, the men and women of the port town referred to the on-paper illicit commerce with the British and Dutch by the sanitized term foreign trade. Precious metals drove entangled consolidation, as they could be swapped legally and illegally for all sorts of European goods. Even runaway slaves participated in these economies. The Atlantic ebbed and flowed with silver. Treasuries depended on it, and regions vied with one another to produce and sell it. In fact, with the density of networks emerging in the Atlantic, silver production began to shift in Spanish America from Potosí to Bajío in New Spain. Soon, Mexico City would grow wealthy through the exportation of silver, and mines in New Spain became engine rooms of further Atlantic systemization. That silver, most of which crossed imperial lines, could be found throughout Europe. Gold also sustained line-crossing networks. Brazil imported most of what it needed from countries other than Portugal, and gold mines in Brazil allowed it to do so. Gold, traded through convoluted networks, proved critical to Britain's ability to wage war in the 18th century. For the Spanish and the Portuguese, so close to each other in South America, smuggling became the chief economic activity for some regions. The porousness of the vast Spanish Empire, spanning two continents, made it difficult to police, and in some regions, such as the Spanish Main and the east coast of Central America, crossing imperial lines became a way of life. Piracy, not surprisingly, flourished as well. In places like the coast of Venezuela, so close to the port towns of the Caribbean where the traders of so many countries vied, smuggling was the norm. Even the British employed Spanish traders as go-betweens with the even more hated French. For their part, the French relied on Anglo-Americans, who provided a great deal of the timber products that went into creating sugar mills in Saint-Domingue. Entanglements encompassed regions far removed from one another. The merchants of the city-state of Boston had created a connected world tying together such far-off regions as Peru and the Netherlands and Germany. Their trade relied on the links between West Africa and the West Indies. These ties involved ships fitted out for the scavenging of Spanish wrecks. In fact, Daniel Defoe commented on one of these episodes at great length. Even if entanglement has become an all too trendy concept, the term captures what was emerging as the defining characteristic of the 18th century Atlantic. In the 18th century, connections and entanglements drove processes, events, and peoples. They enriched, oppressed, infuriated, excited, and complicated. In the provinces, they created a cadre of wealthy merchants and planters who made fortunes from the exploitation of labor and the trading of goods, both of which depended on the crisscrossed nature of the Atlantic. British officials believed that up to one-third of all American trade was illicit. Most infuriating was that an alarming amount of trade involved colonists with Britain's traditional enemies. Tangles could be convoluted. Ships from New York and Boston engaged in complex series of deals with Dutch traders in French ports and with planters from Saint-Domingue after crossing Spanish lines. Portugal grew dependent on grains from Virginia and the Carolinas, which came from Northern Europe. Traders from South Carolina lobbied Britain's Parliament because so much indigo traveled to Britain from the French Caribbean. And Spanish silver, mined in South America, was the currency of choice for merchants who shipped tea to warehouses in England. whence middlemen sent it to America, where it was sweetened with sugar produced by the enslaved from Africa in the Caribbean, especially the French colony of Saint-Domingue. If they could get their hands on cheaper tea, North American colonists would trade with the French and the Dutch, who used their permeable networks, which stretched from Denmark, Germany, and Poland to the Danish Caribbean, Long Island, and Rhode Island. Perhaps as much as a quarter of tea consumed in Britain's North American colonies was of the Dutch or smuggled variety. Throughout the Atlantic, actors transgressed theoretically sovereign boundaries with abandon, and much of the economic vitality and cultural energy of the Atlantic was sustained through such crossings. Entrepôts in both the Old World and the New depended on the autonomy to cross boundaries. Unsurprisingly, nowhere were these growing entanglements more prevalent than in the slave trade. The first few decades of the 18th century witnessed all sorts of traders, acting almost as independent free agents, vying with one another to bring humans across the ocean. The image of a free-for-all comes to mind. The British would soon play a prominent role in this burgeoning arena of free and often unregulated trade. With the end of the Royal African Company's monopoly on the slave trade, all sorts of people now attempted to enrich themselves. Those who could ship the enslaved in the most cost-effective way could supply all empires, whether licitly or illicitly. After the War of Spanish Succession, when the British were granted what was called the asiento, or the monopoly in shipping persons from West Africa to Spanish South America, international tensions only increased. Spanish bullion spilled into the British ports, most into Jamaica, just as the contraband trade in the enslaved grew by leaps and bounds. Ironically, it also hastened the development of the plantation economy of Cuba when the island, too, began producing sugar with a reliance on African labor. Here, the contraband trade dominated, overshadowing licit commerce. Much of that intercourse bound Cuba to Jamaica, and it encompassed slave traders and the enslaved, smugglers, and merchants. The French, too, were becoming reliant on such crossings. Needing access to credit, they relied on Spanish silver to keep their treasuries solvent, and to that end, merchants and officials ensconced themselves in Cadiz, the most important port in the Iberian Peninsula. They also became expert at slave buying, usually from other powers. As these examples suggest, slavery heightened the intensely networked nature of an already complex world. And all throughout the Atlantic were bound to its convoluted imperatives. Enslaving factories in West Africa, British merchants and pilots, and the Dutch as well, supplied the plantations of all imperial powers in the New World. Consider just one town, Ouidah, in what is modern-day Benin. French, British, Portuguese, and even Danish traders operated there. Most of the people traded went to Bahia and Brazil. A great many headed to Saint-Domingue. Later, it would be Cuba. In the New World, the mixing of people could make for some surprising results. In South Carolina, enslaved men and women taken from the Congo, a place shaped by the Portuguese, had military experience, which would be put to good use in rebellion against planter elites, and were Catholic, which would add to the distinctive character of African-American spirituality. Or take the case of the French. French merchant houses, which had tentacles in Cadiz and South America, came to dominate the trade in sugar, leading to the growth of port cities. Fully one half of the sugar consumed in Europe was produced in the French West Indies by the 1770s. This activity had an unwelcome knock-on effect for the British. The rise of French production in particular alarmed the British. Yet their colonists traded with the hated French, especially merchants from New York, many of whom were Irish, and displayed a vigorous contempt for British navigation laws. Ships connected, but people on them entangled. They, especially those who toiled or ventured on ships that crisscrossed the space, created new imaginative parameters of the Atlantic. Just think of two peoples to appreciate the ways all were complicit in creating such an imbricated world. The Irish, mainly Catholics, loaned themselves out as merchants, priests, and soldiers to European sovereigns. And increasingly, this work saw them move throughout empires. Some earned fortunes in licit and illicit trade with other nations. The wealth they accrued, and the connections to the Spanish and the French they fostered, allowed family members to enter the Atlantic net and so help extend networks farther still. Priests looked out after Irish soldiers serving foreign powers. Merchants tried to further the interests of the other two groups, reinforcing connections between places and among occupational groups. The same merchants also worked closely with contacts in London, which was becoming a center of finance for an increasing number of Atlantic ventures. One of the great untold stories of Ireland in this period is how these developments spurred the growth of Irish cities, which made confessional boundaries more permeable. Catholics were not the only ones to adapt to a connected world. Most migrants from Ireland to the British North American colonies were Protestant. Though they left as rents were rising and as land in America seemed available, they simply did not connect the old world and new in a simple push-and-pull fashion. They produced linen, for which merchants, many of whom in both Ireland and America were involved in trade with sugar islands, imported flaxseed from the middle colonies. Their mass movement alarmed British officials, who now worried, because of increased friction with France, about the loyalty of the Irish should war arise. Ireland, after all, was a depot for manpower. Migrants settled on areas that had just been cleared of Native Americans, and they soon made pushes to the west, where they would encounter indigenous peoples allied with the French. The produce the migrants raised on these lands enriched merchants in Philadelphia, who sent what the Irish raised in America to many ports throughout Europe and to slave colonies in the Caribbean. The simple movements of people from one place, then, bound the whole system together in multiple ways, sending out threads to the farthest verges of that system. Saint-Domingue fostered an even more complicated web of connections. The capture of men and women in West Africa transformed the economies there, creating unending conflicts. They traveled to the French colony on the ships of many nations, enriching some but creating envy among others. In places like Saint-Domingue, they produced an addictive substance that proved a cheap energy source and that created new wants and needs in Europe. The most vibrant sector of France's economy was dependent on sugar. The labor of the enslaved in Saint-Domingue created an employment for large numbers of French workers and built the ships and fed the armies that France used to contest British pretensions in the Atlantic. Sugar would spur greater activity elsewhere throughout the world, as the substance was put into coffee grown in Brazil, chocolate harvested from cocoa beans in places like Martinique, and tea imported from halfway around the world. Not surprisingly, merchants from many countries would vie with one another to get it at the cheapest price, usually resorting to smuggling to do so. Sugar underscored whole industries in regions far from the slave islands, in New England, for instance, where it was used to sustain rum production. This employed thousands in distilling and in building the ships to keep supply up with demand, and many more worked to provide wood products and foodstuffs for the clandestine trade to the French islands on ships often outfitted by Irishmen out of places like New York or Spanish ports. Some of these workers in New England would be the same migrants from Ireland who harbored ambivalent ideas about their relationship to Britain. And so it goes. This was a century of what one scholar rightly calls border crossers. In this world, English merchants traded the enslaved to Spanish holdings in the New World. New Englanders shipped their fish to Catholic Europe. Those in the Eastern Caribbean traded counterfeit coins with Jamaicans and Rhode Islanders. Indeed, coins from all countries functioned as currency in the Caribbean. Elites in Buenos Aires enriched themselves with the trade of silver from the mines of Peru and contraband from Brazil, much of which was sent to the British. Traders from Buenos Aires vied with those in Montevideo, who specialized as intermediaries in a number of smuggling networks. Those on the margins could exploit the nature of the system better than most. Natives living on the Caribbean coast of South America, known as Tierra Firme, confounded officials by striking trading deals with French, British, and Dutch sailors. Irish merchants used their ties to the Caribbean, to Catholic France, and to the British to enrich themselves by exploiting the system's interstices. Rather unsurprisingly, inhabitants of the west of Ireland, even in remote Connemara, made smuggling a way of life because of their connections to Cadiz and Nantes, and the scale of it alarmed British authorities. Montrose in Scotland, a town near Aberdeen with ties to the Baltic and to the tobacco trade, became a smuggling center. The layout of Montrose and even the design of homes reflected the fact that here even commerce with the enemy, France, was welcome. England itself was not immune. A collection of smugglers called the Hawkhurst Gang plied their craft in the 1740s with impunity. Smuggling, after all, had become central to the economy of Kent, where they worked. Similarly, a French gang, led by a folk hero named Louis Mondrain, used violence and a rough sense of justice to trade in contraband tobacco and to stick it, proverbially, to the farmer's general, which was supposed to collect duties for the state in exchange for the right to trade tobacco. Most of the trade that occurred, even across imperial lines, was sanctioned, even if in some cases imperial officials gave their blessing to the clandestine to make it legal. Nonetheless, we can be forgiven for thinking that what occurred outside the law defined the Atlantic. Arguably it did. As the system developed, the formerly illicit took on a pronounced prominence and appeared to become representative of what the Atlantic had become, especially because the law created complications of its own. The rate of change outpaced the ability of the state and its administrative apparatus to manage flows. Moreover, laws had been established earlier on to stop what we could call rogue entanglements, but officials had a stake in boundary crossing. London's wealth depended on the Atlantic. The same went for provincial cities, some of which were wholly dependent on the entangled system. The case of Bordeaux and Cadiz are telling examples. Both places grew and developed as Atlantic cities, and they were transformed just as much, if not more, than New World entrepôts such as Philadelphia. These two places represented almost perfect manifestations of what made the Atlantic a system. Both tied slave societies in the Caribbean and along the Spanish Main to the metropoles. Both became nexuses for the development of wealth. Both yoked Creole elites culturally and economically to their mercantile confreres in the metropole. Both served as hinges between the Atlantic and the capitals Paris and Madrid. Finally, Cadiz and Bordeaux were sites where what would have been discrete networks converged. Inhabitants here, too, thrived on the sort of illicit trade that by definition crossed imperial realms, just as they needed elites conversant with the trade and culture of other empires. If any one nation epitomized the New Atlantic, it would be the Netherlands. The Dutch acted as go-betweens between different powers on a sizable scale and traded the enslaved with whoever would pay the best price, from Brazil and Portugal to the British Caribbean. The islands the Dutch held in the Caribbean, such as St. Eustatius and Curaçao, became way stations for ships of all nations, as Dutch merchants disregarded laws and conventions. In these polyglot places, inhabitants created an almost free trade zone, mixing legal and illegal commerce between the Spanish Main, North America, and the rest of the Caribbean. Dutch Guiana, straddling Venezuela, had become by mid-century a borderless society. The central state did not even try to regulate, nor could the conglomerate, the Dutch West India Company, which was responsible for the plantations there. Empire here, if we could call it that, was improvised and created on the ground by people tied to all sorts of trading partners. What developed was what was called the Dutch trade, the illicit movement of goods between the Dutch and Danish ports in the Caribbean, Cap Français and Port-au-Prince and Saint-Domingue, and places in British North America, such as the city that specialized in such traffic, New York. The Dutch trade, which thrived on entanglements, contributed mightily to the consolidation of the Atlantic. Before this time, in the late 17th and early 18th centuries, networks tended to be monoglot and bound within discrete imperial worlds. So men and women from the British world, as a rule, corresponded with others within their national circle, even if the connections they created spanned the ocean. Benjamin Franklin serves as a prime example. However worldly he became, in the early years of his professional life, his networks incorporated mainly English-speaking regions within a world circumscribed by British sovereignty. With time, this changed. Franklin's correspondence came to include those from a broader sweep of the Atlantic, and his lines of connection intersected with those of others who also had been writing within monoglot cultural worlds. Through such crisscrossing, what we could call a republic of letters was born, one that drew from any number of Atlantic cultures and could not be tied down to sovereign claims. Franklin was only one rather well-connected node in a complex and growing epistolary network, which itself was the sum total of other overlapping webs, each developing along with the Atlantic. Franklin epitomized another key change. Print culture developed to allow a necessary flow of information, both the sort that strengthened distinctive imperial lines and the sort that allowed crossing. The newspaper could be likened to the internet of the age. It offered people fingertip knowledge of the latest happenings in the world beyond their purview, facilitating further integration. Franklin's preoccupation with issues such as provincial agricultural improvement and the circulation of currency throughout the Atlantic system stemmed from his access to print in his brother's newspaper shop and eventually to the newspaper he owned, the Pennsylvania Gazette. Print made this world go round every bit as much as trade. Not coincidentally, he published essays arguing that paper currency would entice even more migrants to Philadelphia. He suggested, in other words, that Americans needed to embrace the burgeoning system's imperatives. These views were shaped by the work of others throughout the crisscrossed Atlantic, Not coincidentally, French theorists would turn to Franklin to argue that France had to follow suit. Because he worked in the newspaper business, he had his fingers on the pulse of a world of information that was becoming as interlaced and as sophisticated as the very changes he tried to digest. System and ideas intersected to sustain the globalization of imagination. Atlantic print networks stretched from Boston to Halle, where J.J. Griesbach was educated and where he published his most important works on the Synoptic Gospels. Atlantic consolidation produced the ideas that animated people on both sides of the ocean. For the French, nearly 3,000 titles on the subject of political economy appeared over the course of the century, with the lion's share published after French Atlantic commerce took off in the 1750s. These works came out at a faster pace than the very form we associate with modernity, the novel, and their appearance encouraged French readers to go further afield and read the works of notables in other places struggling with the same issues. A 1754 advertisement, for instance, noted that the translation of one of David Hume's treatises on political economy was...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.